Hey. How's it going, brother? Shaka, brother. Hey, we got a special guest today. You're right, this is always loud. Always ends up too loud. This is Tice from a local band. Do you call it punk thrash?
Yeah. Okay. Punk thrash, hardcore metal.
Named Golgotha. And we want to spend a few minutes here, beginning of the show, just kind of talking to Tice and seeing what's going on with him. And personally, he's a special blessing to me because he's been going to a bunch of the shows we've been having. Way back, One Bad Pig, and in fact, we're going to show a little of that footage of these.
All right.
Yeah, when he was, you were about, what, about that big? No, all you guys from Ingleside and Aransas Pass coming over there and having a good time at the One Bad Pig show we had at Bayfest back in 90.
Yeah.
That was 1990. About 3 years ago, huh? Man, that's been a while, hasn't it? Yeah, where's the time gone? Heck, this show's been on, what, 3 years now? Almost. Who cares?
Yeah, I've been watching all 3 years, too.
Yeah! He's touched. Touched in the head. Anybody watches the Hatin' Satan show that long, something's got to be wrong with him, I tell you. But we're going to let Tice tell us a little bit about himself. I understand you're from California.
Yeah, I was born and raised in San Diego. I moved to Texas when I was 18 for a little while, and that's when I met Mike, and he had turned me on to that Pig show that he was doing at Bayfest, and said this is like his first show that he brought down, Pig, and man, it was awesome. It was just a killer show, and then afterwards at Zero's, all the ministry they had going on there, it was awesome. And then unfortunately, I had to go back to California to do some schooling, but I returned this last semester, and I'm now a junior at Del Mar College, and working on my accounting degree. So I'm at Del Mar now. I'll be at CCSU pretty soon.
And so education pays off, right?
Definitely.
All right.
I take my education seriously.
Well, you know, there's one thing about that's looked at Christians a whole lot is that a lot of people think that we're monolithic in our thinking, that we only think of one particular thing in the gospel. Now it's all that matters, and that's not always true. We're very big on being productive citizens, going out, you know, taking your education as far as it'll go, and getting a good job, and being a part of society, and doing what God wants you to do. That's the main thing. And the idea that we're more heavenly minded, that we're too heavenly minded and no earthly good.
Right.
You know, there's a balance there. And part of that is going to school, getting a good education, and being a productive citizen. Because the more you know, the more you can do. And,
that's right.
I just encourage you to continue going on. Yeah. But I wanted to touch on some of the music that has influenced you. Maybe you could tell me a little bit about your Christian testimony and how music was important to you before you were saved, and even after you were saved, or how it influenced you.
Okay. Sure. I was saved when I was about 6 years old. I was growing up in a Christian family, and I really thank God for that too, because that's helped me out a lot. And I've been to church and Sunday school all my life, just like a lot of people have. And I really thank God that my parents brought me up in a Christian living. And like I said, I got saved when I was about six, and at about age, I guess I was about 16, I had started falling away from God and not really living the life that I should have been. You know, peer pressures took over and stuff like that. And about 18, I finally just got right with God and tried to get my life back on track to where it should have been. And that was about time that I started getting into Christian music really heavily. I grew up on stuff like Michael W. Smith and stuff like that. I was about 15 or 16, and it started developing as stuff I liked, the heavier stuff that I was playing, and I got into bands like, I started getting heavier with Petra, and then it eventually evolved into stuff like Vengeance Rising and bands like that, and Crucified. I really started taking those
bands.
That's
a quantum leap there,
right.
From Petra to Vengeance Rising.
But, yeah. So anyways, music, it started getting a really good hold of my life. I was digging deeply into the lyrics that were there, because I had a lot of people just tell me, you know, that Christian heavy metal, that's not Christian, that's junk, you shouldn't be listening to that, that's of the world, that's the devil's music. And that really hurt me bad, because I was really into that, and I had read the lyrics and really got a lot out of it, and here was people, Christians just bombarding me with all this lies and stuff.
Nattering nabobs of negativism, right?
That's it, man.
That may be a little bit before your time. That was a quote from Spyro T. Agnew from early 1970s. See, he was a... never mind.
Before my time.
He was a Republican vice president with Nixon, and he was always slamming the press because they were always giving Nixon a hard time and everything, and so his speechwriter came up with these little puns. It's called the Nattering Nabobs of Negativism. That was the press, so I just thought I'd throw that in there just for grins. For you nostalgia buffs and for those of you who are older than me and younger than Tice. But anyway, we'll continue on. But it's really discouraging to a lot of the young Christians. I talked to a youth leader, well, it's been a few years now, and I said, listen, we've got the show coming up. I'd like for you to put some posters up, and maybe you can give a little talk before the... before the youth group and let them know that we've got this group coming and get your youth involved, you know, invite their friends from school and let's make this a big thing, you know. And his response to me was, well, you know, I'd really like to, but I've only got just a couple of kids in my whole youth group who are into this kind of music. I'm talking about thrash or hardcore, something like that. And so it kind of discouraged me because what you were talking about is that you were talking about how you fell away for a bit, and there seems to be a black hole in a lot of young Christians' lives between, I guess, the ages of about 15, 16, 17, and when they're in their early 20s, is that the church really isn't meeting their needs. And I'm not saying that you have to go to church and that the pastor has to plug in Vengeance Rising or some industrial stuff to appease the youth, but I'm just saying that a lot of the youth leaders need to wake up and realize that a lot of the kids who are not coming to church are not coming to church because nobody's tried to reach them, right, or nobody's tried to take time to find out what kind of music they're into and what is a Christian alternative to that music, or just to be able to relate to them. You know, they say, well, you get too much into a clique. And I go, well, that's probably true, but that also works in an opposite way. A lot of the Christian kids who are into the alternative scene or into the hardcore metal scene, they see the Christians clicking in the Michael W. Smith crowd or the Amy Grant crowd or the Petra crowd, and that's all they ever see is posters of these cats. And so there's no credibility lent to the guys who are out there really slugging it out in the trenches, such as Deliverance and Mortal and the Crucified and some of these other bands who have been out there doing the club scene.
Right.
And I'm not talking about just doing some little Christian happy shows. I'm talking about getting out there and preaching the gospel boldly and being physically attacked at times for it. And Tourniquet, you know, when they went to the Milwaukee Metal Fest,
yeah,
and Glenn Benton of Deicide tried to stir the crowd up to beat up the Christians. He said, I sense that there's Christians in this crowd, and I want y'all all to just beat them to death. That was Betrayal?
Yeah, Betrayal. That was in San Diego, too.
Oh, I stand corrected. You're fired. Anyway. Bye. Well, it was Betrayal. But still, you know, Tourniquet, you know, has had some problems with Glenn Benton. You know, we talk... in fact, I may show a little bit of the interview with Ted Kirkpatrick, where he talked about Glenn Benton and the troubles that they've had with him and his censorship of Christian music. A lot of people, you know, when you pick up the Village Voice, and for instance, right here it says the ADL, which is the American Defense League. I believe it's the American Defense League. It's a Jewish organization, and they were trying to take care of a lot of the anti-Semitic type literature that are in libraries and colleges, campuses, and stuff like that. And so the conservatives are always looked upon as being censors and that type of thing, just because we don't want to fund works of art such as, and I use that term loosely,
right,
with the Robert Mapplethorpe photo exhibit, where it's the homosexual erotic art and things like that, and some of the other performance art where people smear human fecal material in each other, or the guy, what's his name? I forget what the guy's name was, but what he did was he took a jar of urine and he immersed a crucifix in there, and that stuff's being paid for by tax dollars. I don't see anything wrong with somebody going out and pursuing their art on their own money, but when you involve the public tax money to fund that type of stuff, you're off the wall. So when the conservatives speak up and say, hey, we don't want to spend money on this stuff, we abhor it, we think it's off the wall, and we don't want to pay for it, then we're looked upon as censors. But yet when it's on the other foot, and it's a real prevailing wind these days, is Christian bashing. We're always talking about people getting down on Rush for telling the truth about Bill Clinton and things about the liberal media here in America. But when a Christian stands up and wants to be a heavy metal rock and roller, or he wants to speak the truth or talk about his faith and things like that, just like in the schools, well, hey, we're run out of town on a rail. We're not allowed to talk about the things that are important to us because it's Christianity, and right. We're intolerant and we're divisive and all this other, and we're Neanderthal and all that kind of stuff. So the censorship works both ways, and frankly, we're tired of it. And that's why we have this show on, is because on public access, they can't censor you.
Right.
Unless we get up here and take our clothes off and run naked. And then even then, like in Austin, where they had, it came on at 2 o'clock, it was a AIDS awareness group got on there and did a safe sex show. No joke. They had close-ups of male and female genitalia, putting on condoms and oral sex and masturbation and things like that. And that's on public access, so you'll never see those things on the Hate and Satan show, I can guarantee you that. But, you know, that's what public access is all about, is that we're able to come on here and preach the gospel boldly. We're able to come on here and talk about issues that affect the Christian community, things that come up in the media. I think it's real important that Christians... I'm talking too much. we're gonna take a break, and we're gonna slam a little bit with I don't know who we're gonna have on. We'll probably have the Slam Cat on again. These are a really cool band from Oklahoma. In fact, they're coming down November 13th. Why don't y'all stay tuned? Give us a call at 939-9208, and we'll give you some more information later on about the Fall Metal Fest in Austin. And Slam Cat's going to be there, and possibly Betrayal. So stay tuned.
See ya. We'll be right back.
because we got a purpose, we got to fight. That's with Satan, that's not with each other, man. We got to stand together and pray, lift each other up, and build each other up, because, man, we got a strong battle out there, folks. We got to get ready. We got to do our work. So, some we're going to do is called Stupidest Things. Basically, about we just need to worry about what God thinks about us. Are we pleasing God? You know, don't care anything else about this world. What people think about you, what your parents or anything, you know, God is the one you got to please. Because when you stand in front of Him on Judgment Day, He's going to be the one we got to account for. And He's going to be there. And we got to bow to Him and only Him. Six sons of Stupidest Things.
Thank you. We got Miguel on bass. We got Mr. Kyle Rasmussen on vocals here. And guitar.
Smoking head once again. We're literally in a garage here, and the dogs have been inhabiting the place, and they've left great mounds of ugly things in here, and so we've got this to kind of make it habitable.
Right.
Anyway, I wanted Ty to talk about a book he brought over here. It's by a cat by the name of Bob Larson.
He's a radio talk show host, if anybody doesn't know. He's out of Denver, Colorado. And right now his show is only being aired out of like about 200 cities. He was in San Diego, but then they didn't get enough ratings, so they cut that down. Anyways, Bob Larson here, he's got a talk show that deals with a lot of troubled teens. And when his show first started, it was, he kind of went along the line of helping kids out of like alcoholism and drugs.
And Satanism.
Yeah, Satanism developed. That was later. He didn't get much into it, but then that got he got really heavy into helping all the kids who were trapped in Satanism. And he wrote a book. He's written several books, and along with his talk show. Anyways, he wrote a book called Dead Air, which is before this book. This book here, Abaddon. Abaddon means Angel to the Abyss. This is a sequel to Dead Air, and it's a fictional book based on a true story. Anyways, it talks about how this guy tries to save this girl out of Satanism, and she's been sexually abused by her father, and her father's the cult member from his cult. And I've heard Bob Larson for 2 years, and this guy, he just shreds, man. He is so awesome. He's such a leader. And he's just saved many people out of Satanism. And the guy, he's just awesome. If you like, if you're interested in that stuff, or if that stuff like, or if you're in that kind of stuff, Bob Larson, man, he's good.
Highly recommend the book, huh?
Yes, definitely.
Yeah. You know, bringing up the subject of Satanism, you know, Satanism takes on the form of many different things. According to Anton LaVey, who wrote the Satanist
Satanic,
Bible,
yeah.
Satanic Bible, basically says that, well, he doesn't believe in God. He doesn't really believe in the devil. He just says that his definition of Satanism is simply anti-Christian.
Right.
It's everything that is directly opposite of what Christianity teaches. If you teach, if Christianity teaches abstinence, then Satanism teaches indulgence.
Right.
If Christianity teaches charity, then Satanism teaches that you do not give charity to those who don't deserve it. You know, just survival of the fittest. You know, stomp on who's the weak, the old, the lame, the young. You know, just whatever fulfills your own desires or your own power needs. You step on everybody else. It's a real self-centered type of philosophy. But there was an article a few weeks back in the Caller Times, and they had raided a local drug dealer, local gang member's house, and they found a little altar in there, and there was stuff that was incense. Well, not like this. This is just for the dog poop. But there was incense and confusion powder and candles and things, and they found the names of police officers who were assigned to the juvenile division, the gangs, you know, the ones that work with the gangs and try to clean that whole thing up. And a lot of the police officers said, well, you know, they weren't very impressed by that whole thing. They didn't think that, you know, that it really affected them. They thought it was like a big joke and stuff like that, that they're not too scared. And I'd just like to personally say that, for the most part, you're probably right, but also you need to be aware of that if you're not a Christian, that there is a real devil. There is a real angel of the abyss. His name is Abaddon, or Apollyon, the destroyer.
Right.
And his name is Satan, the serpent of old. He really exists. And it was way back in the 60s where they said that, you know, God is dead, the devil's dead, there's no such thing as the devil. And that's the first thing that he would like for you to think, is that he doesn't exist and he doesn't have any power.
Right.
And the fact of the matter is that there is a devil, and that you can believe that if this stuff didn't work, then nobody would be doing it. They found out that down in Matamoros that there were those guys who were cannibalizing all those people, and they had all those human sacrifices and stuff, was that they really believed that they got some power out of that stuff. And some of that stuff does work. It really does. People wouldn't be doing this. People wouldn't be worshiping Satan or into witchcraft or into voodoo or Santeria or any of those other things if they didn't think that it really worked. And it really does. And you need to be concerned about that. But there is victory, though. See, Jesus defeated the devil on the cross.
That's right.
He defeated him. He went down to his own place. He took him out, made an open display of him down in the bowels of the earth, down in hell, took all the captives home to heaven to be with God the Father. And you don't have to fear the devil. You don't have to fear curses and spells and all that other stuff. But the only way you can have victory over that is through the blood of Christ.
Exactly.
And I know that this kind of is foreign language to a lot of people when you start talking about the blood of Christ and sacrifices and things like that. But if you just read the Bible and find out what's true in there, it talks about those things. And the sacrifice that Jesus made on the cross not only defeated death, hell, and the grave, but it gave us new life. It gave us strength to be more than conquerors over the devil. The Bible says that we greater is he who is in us, that means the Spirit of God, than he who is in the world, which is the spirit of confusion, the spirit
right.
of Satan and all those other things. So we don't have to fear those things. You are correct. We don't have to fear those things. But you need to be covered with God's protection and not of your own, because that stuff can work.
Yeah, exactly. There's, you know, there's a lot of people who just don't know a lot about the subject. And, you know, these Satanists, they thrive on intimidation and stuff.
And ignorance.
Yeah, exactly. And I was like that too before I started, you know, reading the material and getting to know. See, I didn't know about a lot about multiple personality disorders and stuff like that until I read about and heard about it and just heard people who had multiple personalities, and then it like really hit me and started going, man, this, you know, this stuff is for real. It's just not a bunch of joke or a bunch of hype, man. It's real. It's a daily spiritual warfare.
It sure is. We knew somebody. What, you thirsty? Mark, we need tunes. That's what I'm doing over here. We're tuneless. I hope the tape stays in there because it's an ancient boombox and it may fall apart. But are we still on here?
Yeah.
Oh, man. Anyway, but we're talking about some serious stuff. And I tell you what, there's a lot of good books out there. There's one called Piercing the Darkness by Peretti. And Frank Peretti, these are super good. They're fiction, but they're based on truth. They're based on the Word of God, and you need to get this stuff. If you're into that type, if you're into that Stephen King nonsense, I mean, if you want to go and get scared, and your mind is like a computer. What you put in is what you get out of it. And if you fill your mind with Stephen King and all this other garbage, I'll call it garbage because it's simply entertainment. I agree, but at the same time, it's a waste of time, is what it is. And if you're into that type of, you know, that heavy duty, you know, if you want to get scared, read the real thing. Read the real thing.
That's right.
And check these books out, and you'll be enlightened, and you'll find out that there is a spiritual warfare going on. And that's why we do this show. It's the Hating Satan show. We kind of joke and have fun about it, stuff like that. But we know that the devil's not laughing. You know, when we come against him in the name of Jesus, he's not laughing. He's being defeated all the time. That's right. And we just, anytime the devil reminds you of your past, you need to remind him of his future. And what we're going to do is we'll probably show you a little flash of the old devil going into the abyss once again.
Yeah.
You know, that's always been a classic. And we'll probably show you a little bit of that because that's where he belongs, is in the abyss.
That's right.
But anyway, what do we got here? Well, we're just about ready for another slam break here.
Slam? Let's do it.
Let's slam. I slam. Hey, if he falls down, pick him up.
That's right.
But who are we going to see? Oh, yeah. Hey, before you go, cool video. We're going to be showing you some of this. It's Doug Van Pelt's Heaven's Metal video magazine. We're on here.
Corpus Christi's on here.
Not me. Right. Are you in the video?
Yeah, I'm in the video.
Unbelievable. It was Jesus Freaks in Robstown. We made the big time. This goes out all over the world. It's a video magazine for Christian metal. Heaven's Metal produced. Doug Van Pelt. Hello, Dougie. Anyway, hey, we made the big time.
And he plugged Hating Satan, too.
He sure did. All right. But anyway, we're going to have a little bit of Jesus Freaks on there and a little interview with them and also a new band called Oblation. Hey, heavy-duty death metal that points you to life.
That's right.
And we'll see you later.
Out of here.
Buddy!
We're Jesus Freaks, and we're hanging out here with Doug Van Pelt in the Heaven's Metal office here. We got Steven over here, he's hanging out with us too.
I'm Eric, I sing for the band, play bass.
My name's Lance Allen, I'm the drummer for the band.
Who are you? Anyway, what are you doing?
Jack, I'm the guitar player. That's what I do. We just crawled out of our motorhome this morning at 10 o'clock or whatever, so we're all kind of dead.
Yeah, way too early to do anything. Yeah. You pretty much. We're on the road, just touring, and we're out here completely for the sake of ministry. We're out to reach the kids. We want to take time with the kids, and we're using our music as a tool. We totally enjoy it, but that's not the reason we're out here, and it's not necessarily that easy or that fun, but we're having a blast anyway. The Lord's really coming through. We're basically thrash. We try to have the rawness that we can find, in as much as we can find, as much energy as we can find, and we try to, I don't know, it's been linked sometimes to like to the Ronettes of the early Vengeance. We have a lot of grooves in it.
Just make sure you buy the tape.
That's Zach's point right there.
If anything, if you guys see this, write us, get in contact with us, because we really want to talk to you, we want to share with you, and we just want to get personal and talk one-on-one.
That's right.
I'm Billy and I play drums.
I'm Mike and I play lead guitar.
We've been together about 2 years, and Mike joined us probably about 6 months ago.
Play death metal for, number one, we like it. Number two, there's a big need for ministry in the death metal scene due to the negativity and satanic overtones in most of the songs. Kids in that scene feel useless and they feel hopelessness, and that's all they feel. And they need to know that someone loves them and cares for them. They need to know that God is not religious, God is not judgmental until Judgment Day. And they just need to know that someone cares for them no matter what they've done.
We hope that the Lord uses us to reach the kids that are listening to DSI and bands like that, and to minister to them and to show them that the Christians aren't hypocrites and religious and just out with a bunch of rules on how you get to heaven and all this junk. We want to show them the true love of Christ, you know, to show them that the Lord loves DSI Singer and all those guys. He died for them just as much as he died for the 12 apostles.
We pray that he'll do, you know, many miracles. We pray that, you know, people that are being possessed will be set free. Pray that people will be set free from drugs and just from the bondage of this life.
Whatever his will is what we want, because we love God with all our hearts, souls, and minds, and we want to praise him through, which may sound weird, death metal music. Our video, Dead Unborn, deals with abortion, and it shows you what abortion actually is, but it's to make a point that it's wrong. It does take a human life, and God doesn't like that. And through the video, we're just trying to show you that abortion is not a right choice. God has a plan for that baby and a purpose for that baby's life, and it's not to kill it.
Even the song Dead Unborn, you know, it's not one of it's not the best song that we have, but we really felt it from the Lord to do the video over the subject of abortion. This is my daughter, Faith Reese, and this is just a result, you know, of not having an abortion, and how beautiful a child is. I mean, look at that face.
Yeah.
This is Lance Hahn, the drummer of Jesus Freaks, and I guess all in all, and everything that you've been watching and all the show, all these bands are basically around for one reason, and that's to reach you. Or
Bible says that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, and no man comes to the Father but through him. And it's just too risky.
Hey, we're back.
Hey, do you ever listen to Rush Limbaugh?
Every now and then.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Yeah, well, I'm a fan of Rush Limbaugh. You know, we don't endorse everything he does, but a lot of the stuff he has to say is really good. And when he begins to talk about conservative values and things like that, those are some of the things that made this nation great, was that there's a lot of people that came over here that wanted to retain godly values. And if that means, you know, a lot of the things that are in the Bible, then that's only good for our lives. There was a friend of ours that made a really good point at church one night. I'll call him Brother Joe. He might get upset if I give his last name. But anyway, what he was saying was that they did an experiment with some school children one time. And the kids were playing in this little playground, little gym set and stuff, and it had a fence around it. They took that fence away just to see what those kids, how they'd react without boundaries. They said they became fearful and anxious and kind of withdrawn. And instead of playing out around the playground equipment and out up to the fence and things like that, they tend to congregate and huddle, and they got really quiet and kind of didn't play out or very outgoing very, very much. They stayed kind of within the monkey bars themselves. And what they found was that once they put those fences back in, that the kids began to spread out and they were happier and they were really into it.
It's like a security.
You're right. It's God's mercy.
Right.
That he has given us boundaries in our lives. These are the things that are set down in the Word of God, such as abstinence from premarital sex, staying away from drugs, not stealing, or all the different moral values that you find in the Bible are there for our protection. It's God's mercy that we have those things. He's not some kind of killjoy up there saying, "Hey, well, I'm going to keep you from having a good time. I'm going to make sure you don't have any fun. I'm going to tell you all these don'ts to do, not to do."
Right.
and so it's God's mercy. There's liberation. I know this is it's a paradox of a concept, but there's liberation in having boundaries. We're free. We are freer people. We're more liberated because God, in his wisdom, has given us boundaries so that we know how far is too far. And that what I'm leading up to is I ran across a few wildlife in the garage here. I ran across a couple of articles. I pick up the Houston paper. I pick up the Village Voice. I pick up a lot of things and just I read a lot of stuff. What? Yeah, there's something creeping across here. Anyway, Berkeley's bear all attitudes still too much for some to bear. But what it is that, you know, that's a college town out in California. And the nudists are all over the place over there, and they want to take part in the city council meetings, and they just want to hang out and just walk around without any clothes on all the time. And a popular postcard captures the fashionable trend. It depicts from the rear a pair of naked women in their 40s walking hand in hand on the Berkeley campus. The nakedness prompted disputes at City Hall, and each time the council met to discuss the action, nudists showed up. And at one meeting, six people were disrobed. At another, a man wore black lingerie on his head. I said, folks, you know, it shows a real lack of maturity. It shows a lack of concern for your fellow man. It shows that you need to grow up and get real. If you think that this is what you know, that you have to do these things in order to show that you're a liberated person, that, you know, that you are more progressive, and that you don't have any hang-ups, and that you're more tolerant and things like that. No, this shows immaturity.
Right.
You know, it's a young teenage kid that just, you know, will go out and burn something down just because he can.
Right.
You know, that is not a sign of maturity. A sign of maturity is when you set boundaries for yourself and just go, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to cross that line. I have certain moral codes in my life that I am not going to violate. That shows a lot of integrity. Doesn't show any integrity if you want to go to a city council meeting and take your clothes off.
Right.
That's ridiculous.
That's intense, too.
That's heavy. I know. And people come up with these excuses like, well, people have the right to do whatever they want as long as it doesn't infringe. And part of that right is the freedom of expression. the majority of the citizenry is enlightened enough so that wearing so that clothing optional situation doesn't upset people. Oh man, that is the most lame. That comes from one of the city council members there in Berkeley. That's the lamest thing I ever heard. Anyway, you know, when we talk about conservative values and things like that, just because you can do things, just because it's legal, doesn't mean that you need to go out and do it. It's not beneficial. Like in the Bible, it says that all things may be lawful, but not all things are beneficial.
Right.
Not all things produce fruit. And just because you can run around naked out in public, I mean, so what?
Yeah.
You know, what's your point?
Yeah. That's unreal.
But anyway, you got the Bible open here. What were you going to...
Well, I was just thinking, you know, I was talking to a guy in one of my classes last semester, and he was telling me about his girlfriend and all just the stuff that he was doing with her, and I was just like, he just came up and told me, and it's like, and I was saying, you know, I'm a virgin, you know, and he goes, you're what? I said, I'm a virgin. He goes, that's impossible. Nobody's a virgin in the 90s. I mean, that's the thing. And it's like, no, I'm serious, man. I mean, I have my life devoted to God, you know. I don't need to have sex with my girlfriend, you know. And this verse just came over to me. It says, you know, dear friends, I urge you as a... This is 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 11. Dear friends, I urge you as aliens and strangers in the world to abstain from sinful desires which war against your soul. Live such good lives among the pagans that, though they accuse you of doing wrong, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day He visits you.
Sure.
It's like, man.
I think it's an attitude of a lot of Christians these days is not so much, is what I'm going to do, is it going to please God? I think in the back of most Christians' minds is, how much can I get away with,
right,
and still stay saved? You know, it isn't so much, gosh, can I drink a beer? You know, can I get away with it? Can I go and do this, or can I play with my girlfriend or my boyfriend or whatever it is? And I think it's the attitude of, as should be, that is what I'm doing pleasing God?
Right.
You know, and I mean, that should affect all of our lives. Mm-hmm. I think that there was another article in the Houston paper that caught my eye, and it was Lesbian Presbyterian Takes Fight on the Road. And, you know, I think we're missing the point here.
Yeah.
She says that she's a, the Reverend Jane Spar. And I don't know where she's from. She's from New York or something like that. But she goes out, she's an evangelist for gay rights and stuff. And I mean, we're missing the point here, folks. I'm not going to sit here and spout scripture about how wrong homosexuality is, how it's denounced in the Bible. But this is part and parcel of what's going on. This woman is opposed to going around and just preaching the Word of God. Of course, she's not qualified to do because she's gay. I mean, the Bible says that if you regard iniquity in your heart, then God doesn't hear you. And as far as He's concerned, homosexuality is an iniquity.
Yeah.
But the very fact, even beyond that, the fact that she's devoting her time to calling attention to her particular situation, as opposed to going out and preaching the Word of God, is what we're missing the point here. I mean, if she really wants to affect people's lives, preach the liberating word of the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ. Why spend all of your time devoted to talking about gay rights?
Right.
You're missing the point.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. But we're here to honor God. We're here to lift Him up. We're here to glorify God. We're not here to preach rights and what's all this kind of stuff. So, you know, let's deal with what is real here, and the reality is the gospel of Jesus Christ, and the rest of the stuff just falls away as just, you know, nonsense. So anyway, we're just about out of time, but hey, we got a cool little guest here, and he wants to say hi to one of his friends. And we're just about out of here on the Hate and Satan show, but
hey, Justin.
But is he on there? Did you get him?
Yeah.
Okay. Anyway, he's a quiet but integral member of the Hate and Satan crew here, and he's a cool guy. He's one of the big reasons why we do this show, is to provide an alternative to all the young Christian kids out there, my kids also, when they get old enough that they'll have something good to listen to, something holy and that lifts the Lord up.
Yeah.
And once again, check out Heaven's Metal's new video magazine. It's really good. Give us a call sometime at 939-9208. And the reason we don't have the little card up here telling you what number is, because our number's probably going to be changing in a couple of months. We're going to be moving elsewhere, and it's just not beneficial to put that up, because later on we may show the show again, and we all die and go to hell, or... Right.
That is right.
You know, we may want to show the show sometime in the future, and of course that number would be irrelevant, but we're out of here.
All right.
And y'all check out some of this music. We're playing some of the new Mortal album in the background here. It's called...
Fathom.
Fathom. Yeah. He knows all about it. I have to listen to these guys. Yeah. I don't have time to read Heaven's Metal, but these guys do. Anyway, say goodnight, Head.
A savior. I need the Ancient of Days. I need the I Am that I Am. I need the one that Isaiah said he sits on the circumference.